Now, another topic that I want to talk to you about is contract farming. So, yeah, so if you guys have watched my video on the agriculture crisis that we face in India, I talked to you about the role of the APMCs, okay, agriculture produce marketing committees. Okay, so the idea behind APMCs was that earlier on, let's say in the 50s and 60s, the government was worried that the big money lenders and big contractors, etc., would dupe the farmers, and therefore they would buy goods for cheaper from the farmers and then sell these goods at a higher price to the normal public. So it was harming the interest of the farmers, and it was also harming the interest of the public at large. So therefore they decided to come up with an act called the APMC Act, which would basically mandated that there would be APMCs or mandis in every mandis in every, let's say, district or state, and the number of mandis in every state in India, and the farmers are obligated to make sure that the first sale of their produce will only be in the mandis. So the idea was so that the contractors and the middlemen could not go to the farms, and they could not effectively go to the farms and then give lower prices to the farmers, because the farmers would not be aware of what the rate in the market was, right? So the price discovery mechanism was inadequate. Now, to reset that, the government said all the farmers will have to come to the mandis. In the mandis, all the traders, all the middlemen will also have to come to the mandis, and they will buy products from the farmers in the mandis. So once all the farmers are gathered in the mandis, they would be in a better position for, let's say, price discovery, in the sense that they would know what is the adequate and actual and the apt price for their produce, right? So India being India, that model worked for a while, and then that model also got corrupted, and so the middlemen started colluding with each other. They wouldn't outbid each other in terms of auctions, and they started robbing the farmers there as well, right? Just say, for example, recently we saw that onions are selling for 100 rupees a kg. So the farmer who's produced those onions, he's probably sold them for 10 rupees a kg, and you as a consumer are buying them for 100 rupees. It's the middlemen who are making 90% of the money, right? So that's one of the problems with the APMC. If you want to see the problems with Indian agriculture, you can go back to this video that we did, wherein we effectively basically concluded that Indian agriculture has a lot of other problems, which are basically because of well-meaning policies of the government that the government of India has enacted, but it has now, the time has come for these policies to be done away with. Okay, so one step that the government of India has taken is by introducing the concept of contract farming. Okay, so contract farming effectively means that now I will make sure that the farmers not have the obligation to go and sell in the mandi, that it's not compulsory for farmers to go there and make the first sale. I, as an independent party, can go to a farmer, and then I can go to a farmer and say that boss, let's say I'm Lay's, the chips manufacturing company, right? So I can go to one farmer or a group of farmers or a large group of farmers, and then I tell them that, here boss, take these seeds. I want my potatoes to be this dimension, this size, and this quality. If you can produce those sort of potatoes for me, then I will buy those potatoes from you, and you will not have to go to a mandi, and I will also not have to go to a mandi to buy that. So effectively, we will eliminate all the middlemen, and we will do a direct transaction. So under the APMC Act, it wasn't allowed. However, Government of India in 2018 came up with a model Contract Farming Act. Okay, and then they included basically all categories of horticulture and agronomic crops, livestock, dairy, poultry, fishy in the act, and effectively allowed for contract farming. Okay, so now Punjab has a separate law on contract farming. You can read about this act from any of the current affairs sources. I'm not going to go very specifically into this. What is current in this scenario is that Tamil Nadu has become the first state in India to have a contract farming law, which is modeled along the lines of the Model Contract Farming Act. Okay, so the reason why the Contract Farming Act is not a central act is because contract farming is under concurrent list, while agriculture is under state list, right? So center cannot make laws for agriculture. It's under the power to make laws vis-a-vis agriculture rest with the state, right? So if you have a basic understanding of the constitution, there are three lists in the constitution. Okay, now there is the first list is called the center list. It includes all the subjects on which the center has the power to make the laws. Okay, then you have the state list, okay, wherein it contains all the subjects wherein the state has the power to make all the laws. Okay, so you have subjects like policing and agriculture in the state list, right? And then there is another list known as the concurrent list, where both the center and the state have the powers to make laws. However, if there is an inconsistency between the laws that the center has made and the laws that the states have made, then obviously the center's law prevails. Okay, so these are the lists that exist under the constitution. Okay, now, so you must remember that contract farming is under the concurrent list. Both the state and the center can make a law. However, agriculture is under the state list. Okay, so now the state, under the Model Contract Farming Act, which Tamil Nadu has also adopted and made a contract farming act of its own, it has given some exemptions to the parties that are engaged in contract farming. Okay, let's say, for example, they are exempt from licensing and restrictions on the stock limit and movement of foodstuff under the Essential Commodities Act. So the Essential Commodities Act also is a very important act, in the sense that Essential Commodities Act basically tells you that there are certain essential commodities, like, let's say, medicines, food grains, tomatoes, potatoes, whatever, anything can be included under that list. And the government issues and regulates those things, right? So let's say the government basically uses the Essential Commodities Act to make sure that farmers or that traders and middlemen do not hoard essential supplies and then therefore create an artificial demand and then try to sell it for an expensive price, right? So under the Essential Commodities Act, by executive order, the governments can basically tell these warehouse owners, etc., to make sure that their warehouses are empty of all those goods, right? So let's say if the onion prices are rising to the tune of 100 and 200 rupees a kg, then under the Essential Commodities Act, the states can order all the godowns and warehouses to offload their onions in the market so that normalcy can be restored, and so that the high demand for onions, which is causing this increase in price, can also be suppressed. Okay, so now if, let's say, I'm a party which is entering into contract farming, then obviously these conditions cannot apply to me, because let's say I am a company, I am liaise, right, and I enter into a contract with a farmer or a group of farmers to make potatoes for me, then obviously I'm going to need these potatoes over one year's time, right? I'm not going to use all the potatoes and then make the chips as of now itself. Like, I also have a limited capacity to produce these chips. So the reason why a lot of people went into contract farming is because they thought that they might pay the farmers X amount of money and then they would buy from them. Then the state would come in and say that under the Essential Commodities Act, we are issuing an order whereby you have to empty your godown. So obviously me as a company which is engaged in contract farming with farmers would stand to lose out. However, that has been remedied now, and the parties to contract farming are basically, let's say, exempt from the Essential Commodities Act. Now, another very interesting thing that the Supreme Court has done is that the Supreme Court has said that, so basically, mostly in terms of contract farming, if I as a company engage some farmers for contract farming, then I would obviously want those farmers to produce a certain kind of fruit or a certain kind of food, right? Because that food has to match my requirements. Now, one of the ways that I do this is that I give these farmers seeds on my own, right? So the Supreme Court has said that if there is a relationship like this between the farmers and the company, where the company is giving seeds to the farmers and then the farmers are selling the produce back to the company, then the farmers are covered under the definition of a consumer. Okay, this is what the Supreme Court has said. So once the farmer in this sort of a relationship is covered under the definition of a consumer, then all the protections that are given to consumers in general under the Consumer Protection Act become applicable to this farmer as well. Okay, now obviously contract farming, as I told you earlier, also remains outside the ambit of the Agriculture Produce Marketing Committee Act or the APMC Act of the states and union territories, obviously, right? Because the APMC's mandate that the first sale has to be in the mandis. But obviously, if you engage in a contract for farming, then you will not go to the mandis. The whole point of contract farming is to eliminate the mandis and the lots of middlemen that come in here, okay?